Canada. It's so much more than just that place on your ginger ale. They've got intrigue, language politics, backstabbing, and milk that sometimes comes in bags. Since Canada is about to enter into a major national election on September 20th, let's learn a bit about the basics of Canadian politics. Hey, all you bitizens of the internet. Welcome to Learnabit. First, I just wanted to welcome and say a huge thank you to the large number of new people who've subscribed since I made my last video, and also a thank you to everyone who fed the YouTube algorithm gods and made them just so happy. Seriously, I am incredibly honored, and I look forward to building this channel even further for you guys. Alright, so first, before we get into the main topic today, a quick disclaimer. I'm not an expert on Canadian politics. I'm just a YouTuber making an introductory level video on how politics in Canada work on a very basic level, primarily for people not familiar with the topic. There are going to be a lot of major things that get left out due to time constraints, so very sorry in advance. But the point is to get the gist of what Canadian political culture is like and how to watch this upcoming election. And to do that, we'll be examining three things: what political system Canada uses, what the major parties in Canada are, and who leads those parties, and how this election is going so far. Got it? All right. Canada is a federal, parliamentary, constitutional monarchy. Here's what that means. Federal just means the country is divided into smaller units that internally govern themselves and are united under the federal or national government. Canada is divided into 10 provinces and 3 territories, which, grossly oversimplifying here, are somewhat like states, although provinces do generally have less autonomy from the federal government than states do. The parliamentary part is a little bit more complicated, but it's not that hard to grasp, I promise. According to the Encyclopedia Britannica, it's a democratic form of government in which the party, or a coalition of parties, with the greatest representation in parliament, or the legislature, forms the government, its leader becoming prime minister or chancellor. Don't worry, we'll clarify that more in a sec. What's that last part though, constitutional monarchy? Well, you may have heard that Canada still has something to do with the Queen of England, Queen Elizabeth II, and it's true. Canada has a monarchy, and Canada's head of state is actually Queen Elizabeth II, Queen of the United Kingdom. This is obviously a vestige from when Canada was ruled by Britain, but actually the Queen is legally a completely distinct role from the Queen of Britain. Think of it like a second job she has. However, that constitutional part limits her role substantially, and currently her role is largely ceremonial, although it should absolutely be noted that the monarchy does technically provide the literal foundation of Canadian government, and hypothetically, a monarch could actually wield some amount of power if they really wanted to. Which, hey, free alternate history scenario for anyone who wants. However, the parliament and judiciary are almost always left alone to do their thing and govern Canada independently, and most of the day-to-day executive stuff the monarch is technically in charge of is usually performed by a representative in the form of the Governor General, who does things like accrediting ambassadors. Okay, so I really can't get into this more because just this topic alone could be a video on its own, but just know that the monarch is currently largely ceremonial and delegates most of her responsibilities, basically letting Canada govern itself democratically. I'll drop some resources down below if you want to learn a little bit more about this fascinating topic. Alright, so let's get back on track here and talk about this election and clear up what a parliamentary democracy actually is. Canada's legislative branch, or parliament, has two chambers, a House of Commons, which is usually what we're talking about when we discuss Canadian elections, and a Senate, which is extremely complicated and weird, but it's also there. People from non-parliamentary systems can think of them as very loosely analogous to the US House of Representatives and the Senate. The Canadian Senate, on the one hand, is not actually directly elected, and instead all senators are appointed by the Governor General of Canada on the advice of the Prime Minister, so we won't really be talking about them in relation to the election. On the other hand is the House of Commons. Canada is divided into 338 geographic electoral districts, sometimes called ridings. Think of ridings as equivalent to US congressional districts, but for far, far fewer people. When Canadians go to the polls, they're voting for who will be their district's member of parliament, or MP. Whoever gains the most votes, not necessarily the majority, but just the most, will be the MP for that district. whichever party wins the most MPs of the 338 total gets to form the government, and their leader becomes the prime minister, the head of government. So, unlike in the US, Canadians don't actually directly elect the head of government. The House of Commons is the chamber we'll be focusing on for this election, as this is who will determine who governs Canada afterwards. Also, there's one last thing about the Canadian system that will be very important to this election. The winner is not necessarily who wins the popular vote, but rather who wins the most seats. So margins aren't nearly as important as merely winning the broadest possible number of seats. Alright, so who is running to be in Parliament? For that, let's look at Canada's party system. I'm willing to bet that at least some of you think it's probably similar to the US two-party system, but you'd be wrong. Well, sorta. Canada's ideological divisions break down along three major lines: the traditional Western left versus right spectrum, one major language and cultural division, and some geographic divisions. Canada is a multi-party system where two major parties, the center-left Liberal Party and the center-right Conservative Party, I know, very original names here, typically dominate, but other parties wield a good bit of power as well. Let's talk about all these parties and what they're trying to accomplish this election. I don't want to misrepresent the platforms of any party, so I'll talk mostly in generalities, but I will include a good comparison of party platforms down below so you can take a look and decide for yourself. Alright, first off, we'll start with the current governing party, the Liberal Party. The Liberals are a center-left party led by Justin Trudeau, the current Prime Minister, which stakes out positions usually along the center to center-left of the political spectrum. The Liberal Party draws its base of support from younger, more urban, more liberal, working class, and more secular voters, as well as voters in the Atlantic provinces, Quebec, Ontario, and British Columbia, with smaller pockets elsewhere. Trudeau, shown here in beard form, is an interesting character because he's actually the son of a very successful and very pivotal Canadian Prime Minister, Pierre Elliott Trudeau, and is largely responsible himself for bringing the Liberal Party back from one of its weakest periods ever, the election of 2011, when they actually came in third place to the Conservatives and the New Democratic Party. He's also been unusually well known around the world for Canadian Prime Minister. The Conservative Party, on the other hand, is a center-right party currently led by Aaron O'Toole. The Conservative Party is interesting in that it draws extremely heavy support in Western Canada, so much so that even though they lost the last election in 2019, they actually won the popular vote, in large part because of how strong their margins are in ridings in the West. This is part of an ongoing issue in Canadian politics called Western alienation, which is too complicated to fully get into here, but just know that there's a regionalist divide where some in the Western provinces feel underrepresented in Canadian politics. The Conservatives' base of support is more conservative-leaning, more rural, older, and more religious Canadians in Ontario and Western Canada, with smaller pockets elsewhere. They are particularly associated with Canada's very large and important oil and gas industry, one of the largest in the world. O'Toole is an interesting character as well. Although he's the leader of the Conservative Party, he is supportive of a carbon tax and combating climate change, and has even stated he would attend a gay pride parade. Some have noted that he is trying to take the Conservatives in a more centrist direction, hoping to win more moderate voters. Beyond the Liberals and Conservatives, there are two other larger parties and two smaller parties which also exert significant influence on Canadian national politics. The New Democratic Party, or NDP, is considered to be to the left of the Liberal Party and is currently led by Jagmeet Singh, who is the first ever person of color and first Sikh to lead a major Canadian party. It draws inspiration from the principles of social democracy and has very strong relationships with Canada's major unions. Whereas the Liberals position themselves in the center to center left of the political spectrum, the NDP are firmly on the left. They frequently come in third or fourth place, only coming in second once in Canadian history, 2011. Perhaps one of the most pivotal parties this election is the Bloc Québécois, a Quebec nationalist party that obviously only runs in French-speaking Quebec. This is Canada's big language divide between its English-speaking provinces and Quebec. While in the past, the Bloc was a Quebec separatist party, it could perhaps now possibly be described as a sovereigntist party, which seeks maximum autonomy for Quebec within Canada. It promotes the French language and unique Québécois culture within Quebec. The Bloc doesn't always necessarily have a very strong ideological position on many issues, but it could perhaps be described as taking some left-wing stances on things like social safety nets, the environment, and LGBT rights, while the rest of its positions seek maximum autonomy for Quebec. Again, I'll include a link to a party platform comparison so you can check for yourself whether I fairly represented their positions. The Liberals are currently the largest party in Quebec and have traditionally done quite well in the province, but are competing fiercely with the Bloc to maintain or increase their seats there. In the 2019 election, for example, some of the Liberals' heaviest losses were in Quebec to the Bloc. Depending on how the Bloc does, the Liberals' lead in Quebec could easily change, making the Bloc a unique threat to Liberals' federal rule. The two smallest major parties are the Green Party and the People's Party of Canada. The Greens focus largely on environmental and social justice issues. They hold left-wing stances on most issues and are led by Annamie Paul. They currently hold two seats in the House of Commons and will be attempting to consolidate their previous wins and make gains this election. The People's Party of Canada is the newest of the major parties and is headed by Maxime Bernier. While it does not currently have any seats in Parliament, it is currently experiencing an important spike in the polls, up to fourth place in the popular vote. Its positions are described as right-wing, populist, libertarian, nationalist, and conservative. So how is the election going so far? Perhaps the biggest issue of the 2021 election is, well, the election. Specifically, why early elections were called now in the midst of a major fourth wave surge of the pandemic. Trudeau has headed a minority government since elections in 2019, which is a confusing way of saying that the Liberals might be the largest party in Parliament, but they still don't have a majority of seats, so they have had to rely on votes from other parties to help them pass their legislation. So, critics have claimed that calling this election might just be a way to try to boost the number of Liberal seats in Parliament, which has proved particularly controversial in light of the pandemic. Other major issues include the handling of the pandemic itself, the economy, energy and the climate crisis, healthcare, housing, and Indigenous reconciliation, among many other things. Initially, many political commentators believed that Justin Trudeau and the Liberals would have a good shot at increasing their majority in Parliament, achieving their goal. It was believed by some that Erin O'Toole might be a bad choice for the Conservatives, as he went into the election not very well known or particularly popular with Conservatives themselves. However, his fortunes appear to have changed. In the previous few weeks, polling was showing the Conservatives in first place by the slimmest of margins, as voters were seemingly frustrated by the Liberals' decision to call an early election, and as O'Toole attempted to move the Conservatives towards more moderate positions. The two parties are now neck and neck, and anything could change at any moment. The third-place NDP seems to be doing relatively well, possibly poised to pick up a few seats thanks to the popularity of their leader, Jagmeet Singh. The People's Party has fascinatingly rocketed up in the polls to fourth place, while the Bloc Québécois is in fifth place and the Greens are in sixth, both underperforming where they were in 2019. Here are some poll numbers so you guys can take a look for yourselves, and I'll include a poll tracker down below so you guys can watch and enjoy. Alright, so hopefully you now know the basics about this upcoming election and how Canada's political system works, at least a little bit. If you're Canadian, remember the election is Monday, September 20th. Let me know if this format was interesting to you guys. I love this sort of thing, so let me know if you want me to horrifically oversimplify your country's political system next. If you guys believe this video deserved a like, a comment, or even a subscribe, it would be greatly, greatly appreciated. This has been Learnabit. Thank you guys so much for watching, and I'll see you all next time.